Here are 33 creating tips for Geometry Dash, from easy to absolutely insane. And unlike some other videos, you'll actually learn useful things here. Like, did you know the copy and paste buttons work between levels? You can take something from one level and still paste it to another. There's basically no limit here, you can even copy entire levels, which is super useful for merging collabs. Copying and pasting objects saves tons of time, especially with larger projects, but sometimes you'll need to change the groups on those copied objects. For that, you can use the Build Helper button after selecting your objects and the triggers you want to change groups of. If you only have objects or triggers on their own, the Regroup button will do the same thing. And here's another time-saving tip. Scrolling through a level can get annoying, especially with longer levels. But if you're on a computer, you can use Ctrl plus a number key to save a position in the editor. To quickly jump to your saved positions, just use Alt plus the right number key. This makes it much faster to move through levels, which can save lots of time in the long run. Here are some cool things about color channels. If you have an object with both a base and a detail color, you can make some interesting shapes if you make the base color invisible. I've used this before to make things like grass, highlights, and lots of textures. And since we're talking about base and detail colors, there's a new settings gear next to them in Update 2.2. It lets you change if objects are treated as using a base color or a detail one, which can be useful if you're selecting multiple objects. It can be buggy though, so watch out for that. Let's also look at the HSV interface. You may have seen these checkboxes before, and their job is to increase the range for the saturation and brightness sliders. Normally these just go from 0 to 2 times a color's saturation or brightness, but plus 1 brightness can make pure black into white, and plus 1 saturation can make pure white into red. Be careful though, since using these sliders makes these objects unaffected by pulses which use HSV. That's another thing, pulses which use HSV can be really useful. If you leave copy color on channel 0, then use a pulse to target a group, all the objects in the group will be affected by it. This can quickly change colors for objects without having to go through and adjust every single color channel. Now I won't lie to you, the GD editor can be pretty complicated. Thankfully there are help buttons for most things, but they can be a bit half-baked at times. To fix this, I usually suggest making a test levels for things. Instead of trying to learn how a trigger works through a major project, make a new level and toy around with it in an isolated setting. It helps with understanding what may go wrong without getting overwhelmed. And if you want to learn more useful things about creating, then join our Discord server with the link in the description. Now, here are some tricks I've learned about triggers over the years. Like, for one, you should never use the ease out easing. It's actually not coded correctly, so even if it's subtle, it's not an accurate movement. Instead, you can combine the none and ease in easing, as long as your values cancel each other out. So if you have a value of 20 in one trigger, use negative 20 in the other. On the topic of easings, here's a graph which shows how all of them look. It was made by a member of our Discord server, and you can find it in the description. Easings are really useful for making your movements feel more interesting, so you should definitely use them as much as possible. You can also use rotate triggers to make objects move in straight lines. If you take a group and give it two rotate centers, as long as they're the same distance away from your main object and each trigger has opposite values like 20 and negative 20, this will work. Now at first this doesn't seem too useful, but it lets you change an object's movement direction while it's moving, which isn't nearly as easy otherwise. Plus, it lets you make cool things like this. Next up is another trigger pet peeve. Update 2.2 introduced both the reverse trigger to change a player's direction, and the arrow trigger to do the same thing. But please, just don't use the reverse trigger. It's far more limited than the arrow trigger, and even though you don't need to learn how triggers channels work to use it, it has many setup quirks which happen because of that. Rotate triggers also don't work in platformer mode, and they don't adjust the game's music when you use, so you'll need to use arrow triggers to fix that anyways. Since we're already on the topic of channels and IDs, you can enter negative IDs for certain triggers and objects. For example, force IDs and force box can be negative, just like item IDs and pickup and instant count triggers. Item ID 0 also functions perfectly fine, which is useful for quite a few things, although it's not really usable with item edit and some other recent triggers. And speaking of recent triggers, you may know about the spawn trigger's new remap feature, which lets you take triggers that target one group and activate them on another. Thing is, this doesn't just work for groups, but any type of ID, color channels, item IDs, block IDs, and so on. If you're using remaps for any complex reason, this can be super useful to keep in mind. These next 4 tips are some smaller features in certain triggers, but they're still nice to know when you use them. Like, moving an individual keyframe with a move trigger still updates the keyframe animation in-game, so you can make animation presets which change dynamically. When you're using the spawn particle trigger, the scale and rotation values inside it depend on the scale and rotation of the original particle objects, which means things like scaling and warping are still really useful here. Now, if only these spawn particles could follow their sensor groups too, that would be nice. If you've learned both the touch and event link triggers, you might think that touch triggers aren't really useful anymore. but they can still be fairly useful when you disable the player's controls, since they will still activate when the player clicks, unlike Event Link, which is useless in this situation. This means you can make things like cutscenes where the player can't move, but can still skip the scene by clicking. And here's a word of warning, please don't use portals for any sort of center group, like in rotate triggers, static camera, and so on. They show up as one object in the editor, but are actually two when playing in the level. And again, this does mean you can detect if the player is in the editor, which is pretty cool. Since we're talking about portals, I might as well give some gameplay tips of my own. First off, game mode portals. Each game mode in Geometry Dash is like a unique way to approach beating a section of gameplay, so you'll have a different mindset and set of controls with each game mode change. This is super important for gameplay, so much so that I'd suggest you only switch game modes for the most important reason. Don't just use them for visual purposes like sync, and if you want to have rapid game mode changes, try to choose game modes which are controlled in similar ways to each other. When you're done with your gameplay, please make sure you get other people to playtest it. Since you're familiar with your own level, you may not catch mistakes that other people will find and see, and playtesting helps you anticipate your level's reception and adjust things accordingly. If you already do this, you can level up your playtesting by watching people test your levels live or in an uncut recording. Seeing people's intuitive reactions to your level can sometimes be even more helpful than what they say they think, as it clearly shows what parts of your levels are unfair. Fairness is another important thing for gameplay, but it's often hard to quickly see if something is fair or not. Simply put, however, my tip is to not punish players for things which aren't their fault. So for example, if you have some gameplay which is off-screen, please don't kill the player for not knowing that stuff was there. Use camera controls or make that section auto instead. And yes, the player will learn the level and eventually avoid things like that, but it's still less fun to learn an unfair level than it would be otherwise. Another example comes with portals again. Many people stack portals and orbs on top of each other like this, but that can make it hard to tell what's going on at times. Unfortunately, you can't layer portals using Z layers, so I just suggest separating them to make them more readable. But you can layer orbs, so use that to your advantage and put them above portals to make them easier to see. You can also use the show hitboxes option to make sure players enter portals and orbs in the right order, which makes things more consistently. Speaking of consistency, I mentioned it with some of the specific scenarios before, but there's actually a good process you can use to fix any bug. First, try to understand what the bug is. Then take a section of your level which has it and try to identify what's causing it. I like to put things into test levels for this step, since it isolates a problem in a level with less moving parts. And once you've identified what's causing the bug, you can do your best to fix it and get other people's help as well. These last few tips will be deco related, as you could probably guess. One of the most overpowered deco objects is the particle editor, but it can be a complete chore to set up. However, you can massively speed this up by using the particle viewer in the bottom left. If you click the one button while in gravity mode, you can click and drag inside the viewer to set the area where particles spawn. The two buttons set their gravity, and the three sets their angle and speed. If you're using the radius mode, 1 and 2 set the area where particles spawn, and then 3 sets their angle. Another really useful object is glow, which people have been using for ages. But you can make your glow so much better if you're just careful about its colors, like using hue shifting. If you stack multiple pieces of blending glow, don't just give them all the same size and color. Make some pieces larger than others, then make those larger pieces darker and more saturated. As the glow gets brighter and less saturated, you can change the colors to make them more intense. Red and green glow should get more yellow as it gets brighter, while blues should turn more cyan, and purples can go in either direction as you wish. Also, if you're adding blending glow to an object like a light source, please make sure the original object is brighter than the glow you're putting on it. Otherwise, it'll get overpowered by the glow and that makes things foggy, which may not look as good as you want. And since we're on the topic of brightness, it's honestly the most important part of colors. Human eyes are super sensitive to brightness, so if you can distinguish your blocks from your backgrounds, and vice versa, it'll make your deco look better and help with readability. In fact, let me generalize that last tip. In general, you should make certain parts of your deco stand out more than others. The more important something is, the more contrast it should have against its surroundings. For example, having bright block designs against a darker background makes the block stand out, and having an object be larger and more detailed than its surroundings makes it seem more important. Contrast is super important for making a deco, so keep that in mind as you build. Now, I hate to say this, but please, do not use image to GD if you can't stack grade well. It's the same thing as stealing work from others, even if other YouTubers might want you to think otherwise. Something I do recommend though, is getting used to referencing things. Instead of copying an image entirely, you can take ideas from parts of the image, like its concept or certain details. There's an image reference mod in Geode which is useful for this purpose too. This will make your deco more original, and is something that real artists do all the time to work faster. And on the topic of learning art, it's probably the best thing I did as a GD creator. You don't have to make complete masterpieces with traditional or digital art to make good GD levels, but it can help a lot to sketch out your ideas before making them in the editor. Many skilled creators do this all the time too, like Zendergame and Kulik, and it helps them execute their ideas better. If you need ideas in the first place, there are many methods for that, but my favorites are group brainstorming and the scamper method. With brainstorming, you basically just ask other people to help you generate ideas. You can then sort through these ideas later and pick the ones you like the most. On the other hand, scamper takes an existing idea and modifies it in some way. You either substitute something, combine multiple ideas, adapt an old one in a new way, modify its significance, put that idea to another use, eliminate certain aspects of it, or rearrange it to do the exact opposite. And finally, when all's said and done, you may not instantly make good levels. But you know what? That's okay. Good even. Most of the time, you're not under some life or death pressure to make good levels, like you're forced to get creator point. And if you feel that sort of pressure, it's often something you put onto yourself. I know it's frustrating when you expect to make something good but end up just falling short, but don't see it as a failure. It's just another step on your creating journey, one which will eventually take you to your goals. I hope some of these tips are useful for you. If you liked any of them, consider joining our Discord server, where we have tons of guides on how to improve as a creator.